to our souls, we won't bury our hope. Where he leads us to go, there's a It's good to see you here this morning. For those who may be new among us, my name is Paul Massengill, and along with my wife, Amber, we co-pastor here at Genesis United Methodist Church. It's always a blessing and privilege to welcome people to worship. I want to extend a special welcome to those of you who are joining us online or maybe watching this later, and hope that this is a good and blessed experience for you as well. My co-pastor will not be joining us this morning. She's actually coming back tonight, and I'll share a little bit more about that later in the service. But needless to say, I am really looking forward to her being back. So looking forward to seeing her. So a few announcements as we get started this morning. It's always good to have kids among us. For June, you get to stay in here in Big Church. We're giving our children's church volunteers the month off. And so we have worship bags in the back. We have a cry room should that become necessary. Of course, for those who are four and under, we have a nursery. And so just welcome to the big sanctuary for all of our young ones. want to give a big thank you to all of those who helped with the garage sale this week. I haven't heard a number, and so in terms of haven't heard from Troy how much was raised yesterday. So when we know that number, we will communicate that out. But it was a good week, lots of fun, lots of work yesterday afternoon for those of us who were helping clean up. But thank you for all of your help with that. Want to share a few other announcements. Tomorrow is the third of the month, and so as we've been doing for over a year now, pray for UMC on the third day of the month. So invite you to be in prayer with us for our larger denomination tomorrow in particular. Also want to make sure you know about a couple things that are coming up. On Saturday morning, June 15th, there is a special United Methodist Men father, son, or grandfather, grandson breakfast, and want to make sure you know about that. There's a sign-up sheet out in the narthex. You can also just talk to James Lewis, and he can provide you more information about that. There's also this is an annual thing we do during the summer. We help provide snack sacks. That's a little hard for me to say this morning. Snack sacks for United Community Centers. This is an ongoing, long-time mission project that we do here. And so if you'd like to make a contribution toward those supplies, please just indicate that on your gifts. And you can also talk to Doris Howard if you have more specific questions about this project. Finally, one other thing to mention, Project Transformation, which is another ongoing mission project that we support and that our oldest son, Gabe, is an intern this summer here in Fort Worth. We have a couple of opportunities coming up in the next several weeks for providing meals as well as being reading volunteers, where you show up and take a couple of hours in the morning and you simply read with or actually have kids read to you as part of their day camp at the Project Transformation sites. And so if you are interested in that and have some time and would be willing to do that, please see me and I'd be happy to share more specific information with you. All right, I think that's all of our announcements this morning. And so I want to invite our liturgist who's coming up on this side, Alicia, if you would lead us in our call to worship.
Good morning. If you'll stand as you're able, we will have our call to worship. I will praise the Lord at all times. His praise will always be on my lips. Glorify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord and he answered me. He delivered me from all my fears. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the one who takes refuge in God. Please remain standing for our opening hymn.
Defender, the ancient.
join me in the affirmation of faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated.
No, you may not. Please stand and welcome those around you to worship. Be seated. Whenever we gather together in this time and space for worship, we of course want to go to the Lord in prayer. And if you ever have concerns or prayers you would like for our prayer team to be praying for here at the church, we invite you to email us at prayers@genesisumc.com. Of course, that goes for all of you joining us online as well. And our prayer team would be happy to be in prayer with you. As we go to the Lord in prayer as a community, I invite you, as is our custom here at Genesis, that as I say, Lord, in your mercy, that your response would be, hear our prayer. And so let us pray. God, as we gather this morning in your name and prepare later this morning to come to your table, God, we are mindful, as always, that we need to confess and give thanks for the grace that you provide. God, we confess that oftentimes we fail to be the loving people, the obedient church that you desire for us to be. God, we confess that there are times on a weekly basis, on a regular basis, God, when we fail to do your will, when we ignore or break your commands, that we are not led, God, by your Holy Spirit, Lord, that we fail to love and to hear and to respond to those in need, our neighbors around us. And so, God, we just ask that you will forgive us. God, free us from our self-centeredness, our apathy, Lord God, and we pray that your Holy Spirit will do your transforming work in us. God, the grace that we have experienced and that we receive at your table, God, we pray that you will help us, God, to embody and share that grace with others, Lord, and that you will continue to form and shape us into the people and the church that you desire for us to become. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Lord God, we also want to lift up our world and our nation. God, we pray for violence and war and brokenness of nations and communities around the world and all of those people displaced by these conflicts. God, we think, of course, of places like Israel and Gaza and Yemen and Syria and Afghanistan and Ukraine and others. And we just pray, Lord, and lift these places up to you. We pray, God, that your Holy Spirit will surround and protect people, God, and will strengthen and encourage your church to be places of refuge and outposts of light and hope in the midst of darkness. God, we pray for our own nation and our own politics and our own leaders. And God, we just confess sometimes anger and discouragement with our leaders and our politics. God, we pray and confess frustration and hopelessness at times with our systems. And so, Lord God, we pray that you will help us. God, keep us aware and engaged and prevent us, God, from despair and cynicism. God, we pray for so many in our community, Lord God, who need to experience your presence and your healing. God, we pray for families during the summer. We pray specifically for families participating in Project Transformation and in Clayton Youth Enrichment right here in our own building. Lord God, we pray, Lord, that your Holy Spirit will provide for children this summer who are in need and hungry. God, we pray for families with their rhythms disrupted by school being out. And pray, God, that you will provide grace and you will provide support in the various ways that are needed. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. God, we want to lift up our church and we want to lift up those we know and love who are close to us. God, we pray for our church and our denomination. Lord, during this season of transition, God, we pray for Pastor Reuben and his family that you will be preparing them for their time here at Genesis. And pray, God, for all of us as we prepare for this next season. God, we just continue to pray for our community. God, we pray for all those around us, for our neighbors and for our friends and for our loved ones. God, for those we know who are struggling and who are sick. God, who are recovering, who are grieving, who are going through difficult personal seasons of their own. Lord God, we pray that you will comfort, encourage, and strengthen them. God, we pray for ourselves, Lord, that you will grow us, transform us, strengthen us. And God, we pray, Lord, for all people, God, that they would feel welcome here. All people, God, who are invited to experience your grace at your table. Lord God, all of us need your grace. All of us fall short of who you call and desire for us to be. And so, Lord God, remind us that you love and see and value and create all people, and all people are invited to be part of your community. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. And God, we gather these prayers together in the wonderful and the powerful name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And we join together and pray the prayer he taught his disciples to say. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Oh,
Please join me in the prayer for illumination. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word is proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us this day. Amen. Now listen as I read the scriptures from Exodus 14, verses 10 through 22. As Pharaoh drew near, the Israelites looked back, and there were the Egyptians advancing on them. In great fear, the Israelites cried out to the Lord. They said to Moses, "Was it because there were no graves in Egypt that you have taken us away to die in the wilderness? What have you done to us, bringing us out of Egypt? Is this not the very thing we told you in Egypt? Let us alone so that we can serve the Egyptians. For it would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than to die in the wilderness." But Moses said to the people, "Do not be afraid. Stand firm and see the deliverance that the Lord will accomplish for you today. For the Egyptians whom you see today, you shall never see again. The Lord will fight for you, and you have only to keep still." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Why do you cry out to me? Tell the Israelites to go forward. But you lift up your staff and stretch out your hand over the sea and divide it, that the Israelites may go into the sea on dry ground. Then I will harden the hearts of the Egyptians so that they will go in after them. And so I will gain glory for myself over Pharaoh and all his army, his chariots, and his chariot drivers. Then the Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord when I have gained glory for myself over Pharaoh's, his chariots, and his chariot drivers." The angel of God who was going before the Israelite army moved and went behind them. And the pillar of cloud moved from in front of them and took its place behind them. It came between the army of Egypt and the army of Israel. And so the cloud was there with the darkness, and it lit up the night. One did not come near the other all night. Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea. The Lord drove the sea back by a strong east wind all night and turned the sea into dry land, and the waters were divided. The Israelites went into the sea on dry ground, the waters forming a wall for them on their right and on their left. Thanks be the word of God.
All right. Well, good morning again. Several of you yesterday and this morning asked me about how things were in Florida, so I'll just share a brief update. We've certainly appreciated prayers and concerns. Amber's stepfather is improving, and he's transitioned. He's out of the hospital and has transitioned into an inpatient facility, and Amber has spent much of the week arranging for and orienting home health for when he returns home, and Amber's brother gets back tonight, and so she will be getting on a plane here in a few hours and coming back to us, which I'm really excited about. I think I mentioned that already. So we appreciate your prayers and concerns. You also may have read this week in the news and notes that we've asked, because of all that's going on in Florida, we've asked, and the SPR and district have been gracious to approve that we go ahead and move up our last Sunday to June 16th. And so next week, we're going to honor one of our graduating seniors, Annabelle Clayton. So we encourage you to be here for that. And then the following week on the 16th will be Amber and I's last Sunday. Then there'll be a couple of guest preachers, the 23rd and the 30th. And Pastor Ruben's first Sunday will be July 7th. So just wanted to make sure, because I know not everybody reads news and notes, just want to make sure that we're communicating and keeping everybody in the loop on all of that. All right. Okay. Let's invite you now to pray with me. Let's pray. Lord God, we just ask in these moments, Lord, that you would quiet our hearts and minds. God, clear our hearts and minds from anything that would distract us from you. Lord, and may the words of my mouth and the thoughts, meditations of all of our hearts, God, be pleasing and honoring in your sight, our rock, our redeemer, our savior, and our friend. Amen. Well, if you've been with us the last couple of weeks, you know that we are in a series called An Unexpected Journey, Following God in Faith. We are looking at stories from Exodus and the incredible story of God liberating and leading the people into and through the wilderness and into the unknown. And as I was thinking about this series, I was thinking about a very famous poem that many of you, I'm sure, know. And it's a poem entitled Footprints in the Sand. Raise your hand. Do you know this poem? This has been around for a long time. There's slightly different language and words used. I've seen a few different versions, but basically the idea of the poem is that this man has a dream and he sees footprints on the beach, and there's two sets and then there's one set, and he has this conversation with God about that. And you know, God makes the man asks, why did you leave me in these times? And God responds, I didn't leave you, I carried you. And it's a nice metaphor for how we go through seasons in our lives where we need God to carry us, right? And how God does carry us, because God is faithful like that. And so again, there's a few different versions of this poem, but I think my favorite version is actually a little bit different than most of the ones that you've heard. And so I just thought I would share that version with you this morning. And so I'm just going to read it to you. And it goes like this. One night I had a wondrous dream. One set of footprints there was seen. The footprints of my precious Lord, but mine were not along the shore. But then some stranger prints appeared, and I asked the Lord, what have we here? Those prints are large and round and neat, but Lord, they are too big for feet. My child, he said in somber tones, for miles I carried you alone. I challenged you to walk in faith, but you refused and made me wait. You disobeyed, you would not grow. The walk of faith you would not know. So I got tired and fed up, and there I dropped you on your butt. Because in life there comes a time when one must fight and one must climb, when one must rise and take a stand or leave their butt prints in the sand. I gotta tell you, I just love that version. I don't know if anybody's ever heard that version before, but that's my favorite version. I just love it because, you know, of course, yes, God loves us and cares for us. We talk about this all the time. We preach about this all the time. And of course, God walks with us and carries us through difficult times, right? And seasons in our lives. And of course, we are grateful for that. And there are also times when God has been trying to lead us and teach us and reveal to us and command and instruct us through his word, trying to lead us on a path that God desires for us to go. And I imagine God just gets frustrated because we can be stubborn, amen? And we cannot listen sometimes, and we can be afraid to trust, and we maybe don't want to change. And there's a whole host of other reasons that God, I think, sometimes does get frustrated and then just says, thump, and drops us on our butt. If you're a parent, you probably know what I'm talking about. Right? Because we feel this way with our children sometimes. And some of you may feel this way with your grandchildren sometimes, right? And so I think we understand that. And there's maybe no other story in all of Scripture that I think captures and embodies this better than the Exodus story. Of course, the Exodus story is a fantastic story, probably the most important story in the Old Testament about, there's a series of dramatic moments in the Exodus story. And one of those dramatic moments is here in chapter 14. This is the Charlton Heston moment, right? At the sea. This is, or if you're of that generation, or for some of us, it's the Val Kilmer and the animated DreamWorks version of Prince of Egypt, right? Or maybe you know both of those. But this is that moment when they're at the sea and it's very dramatic, and Moses lays out the staff and the sea parts. And again, remember, there's so much that has already happened in the story of the Exodus. Last week, if you were here, Amber talked about how after God delivers the people from Egypt, he leads them the long way around because God knows the people and knows where they are and knows what they've been through and knows that they need to take the long way around and can't go directly to where they are ultimately going to go. And that's part of what has brought them to our story here in chapter 14 this morning. They get to this place and they've already been through centuries of slavery and oppression, and they have wandered the long way in the wilderness, and they've seen God's power confronting Pharaoh, and particularly through the Passover, and they follow the cloud and the fire that Amber talked about last week. And after all that has happened, the people undoubtedly get to the shore of the sea and they're tired and they're exhausted and they're traumatized. And then Pharaoh's army comes rolling up behind them and the sea is before them. And there's this dramatic moment of confrontation, all right? But after all that has happened, they get to this place in chapter 14, and the people simply have to go forward, right? They literally cannot go any other direction. The army is behind them, and God has sent the pillar of fire to divide the army from the people and protect them from the coming army. They literally cannot turn around and go back. And then Moses lays out his staff, and God, it says the spirit or the wind blows all night, and the walls of water appear. It's a very dramatic scene, and there's literally, you've got the fire and the army behind, you've got the walls of water on the side. There's literally nowhere to go but forward, right? And the people are still talking about Egypt in our passage, right? The people are still talking about Egypt. This is the Back to Egypt committee that Amber mentioned last week. Unfortunately, this committee keeps showing up. They're going to keep showing up in the next few weeks too, as we continue in the story. But they're talking about, in the midst of this moment where there's literally nowhere to go but forward, there's still people, because they're afraid, because they're hurt, because they're exhausted, they're still blaming and complaining and talking about Egypt, right? And I can just imagine God, and this is my imagination, this isn't in the text, I can just imagine God kind of in this moment, God thinking, don't you remember how I remembered you and I showed you my power and I brought you and liberated you out of Egypt and I led you and provided for you and I've protected you and I've showed you the way forward. And I'm done carrying. Thump. I'm going to drop you on the shore. And you have to walk into the mud and the muck of the Red Sea that I've parted, this way that I've made. This part you have to step out and do. You have to choose to move forward. Friends, sometimes we get paralyzed. Sometimes we get paralyzed and we really struggle to move forward, right? I see this so many times in pastoral ministry and counseling ministry with grief and loss. People lose someone or they lose a relationship through divorce or something like that. And it's so hard to adjust to that new reality. It's so hard to live without that person or that relationship there. And part of us many times are reluctant to move forward because in some way we feel like if we do that we are not honoring or remembering the one we love and have lost. If we move into a new chapter, we feel like in some way that we're not respecting or loving them as we should. I see this a lot with grief and loss. any of us who have struggled in our lives with someone who is struggling with an addiction, you also understand this paralysis. This paralysis that we can get in. We love the person. Of course, we can't abandon this person. And at the same time, we recognize we can't enable this person any longer, right? And so we find ourselves in this stuck place. For those who've experienced or have a loved one who've experienced depression and anxiety, you probably also know this paralysis, that it's simply because of the thoughts in our head that become a soundtrack over and over and over again that's so difficult to disrupt and change. We simply become paralyzed. We simply do not feel like we can take a step forward. Many of you, I know, understand this experience. Church communities get paralyzed in different ways, a whole variety of ways. Again, because they're afraid of change, or they're holding on to people or memories of the past, or they're simply overwhelmed by what's in front of them. All of us experience this. All of us have been or are in this place. Moving forward can be really, really hard. But it's obvious that the only way to move is forward, right? Just like the Israelites in this passage. Many of you have asked about my new job. I got a new job. Yay for that. And a new full-time job. And it's a counseling position at a local organization called the Center for Neuroskills. And I've been living into this for the last few weeks and learning, I'm really enjoying it. But at the Center for Neuroskills, what we do is that we work with people who've experienced traumatic brain injury or stroke. And so for many of these patients, for many of these people, they've lost the ability to walk after their injury or their stroke. They've lost the ability to speak, some of them. They can't do simple and everyday things that they've just for years and years taken for granted that they can do. And so while most of them are just feeling very fortunate to be alive after their incident, after their accident, life now for them is very, very different. And so they show up at the clinic every day and they go to therapy and they go to occupational therapy and they go to physical therapy and they go to speech therapy and they go to mental health therapy. And they do that and they show up every day and they work so that they can move forward. Because that's the only way they can move, is forward. Again, I expect many of us understand this feeling and have felt this way. And so let's take some encouragement from what Moses says in this passage. He gives a very brief sermon. That's the best kind, right? Brief sermons, right? He gives a very brief sermon in this passage. And I just want to read, there's the Bible. I just want to read again briefly what he says in verse 13. And 14, and I just lost my place. My apologies. Verse 13 and 14, it says this. Moses says in these moments, but Moses said to the people, "Do not be afraid. Stand firm and see the deliverance that the Lord will accomplish for you today. For the Egyptians whom you see today, you shall never see again. The Lord will fight for you, and you have only to keep still." All right, so just to break that down, it says, do not be afraid. In other words, don't panic. Standing there on the shore, you've been dropped on the shore. Don't panic. Yes, it's a scary moment. Yes, it's the unknown as you move forward, but don't panic. Instead, stand firm. Remember, the Lord will fight for you. So keep still. The Hebrew there about keep still, it's actually translated be still or hold your peace. It doesn't mean stay where you are. That's not what the be still or keep still means. It's hold your peace, as the King James translates it. Again, it's not an option to stay there on the shore. The only option is to move forward. So as you do that, it says, don't panic. Stay steady. Be at peace. Remember, God has led you there. God has demonstrated his faithfulness. God is protecting you, even in that moment. God is providing a way through your circumstances. God is with you, so don't panic. Stay steady and keep going. Then in verse 15, it says something that I had never actually noticed before. This happens to preachers, even preachers. It says in verse 15, then the Lord said to Moses, turns to the leader who's been leading him. The Lord says to Moses, why are you crying? Why do you cry out to me? Isn't that funny? The Lord says, what do you want me to do? Why are you crying out to me, right? Tell the Israelites to go forward. So he says to Moses, why are you turning to me? You know what to do. Just tell them to go forward. This is what he says. In other words, tell the people to get off their butts and step out in faith. That's what it says, in a manner of speaking, paraphrasing, right? I want to close with a story. And this is a story that I've shared before here, but it's a story worth sharing again. And it's a story about my first church that I pastored. You may remember, we've talked about our first year of marriage and ministry living in England, and we go to England and we get appointed, each of us, to four little British Methodist church chapels, and one of mine was Ketley Bank Hilltop, which is a chapel that had been founded in the 1840s by one of John Wesley's acquaintances. So I thought that was pretty cool to be serving that kind of congregation. And I show up for their first service on Sunday afternoon, and it's at 2:45 in the afternoon, and I show up, and I walk in, and it's me and 12 other people. And I was a 26-year-old American, and the other 12 people, the youngest of them was 80. And he was a spry 80 at that. All right, and so we had worship and continued to worship in the afternoons at 2:45. And then a couple of months in, the church was right across the street from a park. And a couple of months into that, I was walking into the building, running a little bit behind, and this group of kids was coming out of the park, and they were walking down the street, and I crossed them, and we stopped and started, and they really quickly picked up I was an American because of my accent, and we started talking, and one of the little boys, he turned, and he pointed at the chapel, and he said, what goes on in there? And I said, well, we gather every Sunday afternoon around this time, and we read stories from the Bible, and we talk about them, and we sing some songs, and you'd be welcome to join us. He's like, all right. And they went on, and I had no expectation. The next week, that little boy leads in a group of about 11 or 12 kids. They just finished at the park, and they come into the service. We had doubled in 1 week, right? And of course, I took the sermon and threw it out and just did whatever I did that day with the kids in mind. And then they kept coming, and we started to get to know them and build a relationship with them. And you can imagine what the group of 80-year-olds, how they were feeling about all that, right? And so word started to spread, and people from other churches kind of heard about this. They came over, started to help in different ways. And so we're coming up to Christmas, and the kids decide they're really excited about Christmas Eve, and they want to help plan it. And so I'm like, okay, well, if you're going to plan it, then you got to invite people to come. And they're like, okay, we'll do that. And so we planned this Christmas Eve service, and the kids helped lead in different ways. And they did. They invited their families. They invited their friends. We had over 80 people for Christmas Eve in this little tiny chapel, right? And so everybody was so excited about that. And so we get into January, and we're like, okay, so we got to build on this momentum. And we're like, okay, so we're going to have a work day, and we're going to invite the kids to come out, and you know, we're going to make, it's going to help them feel like this is their church too. They're going to help us out with some different things. And it was really cold that day, I remember. And so me and the kids, we went up into the balcony. Now, the church had a balcony, but nobody had been in the balcony literally for years, mostly because it was a hazard for all of them trying to climb the stairs at their age, honestly. And so, but me and the kids, we went up in the balcony, and I get up in the balcony, and it literally looks like our garage sale narthex. Like all of this stuff that's been collected over the years are up in the balcony. And so the kids, we start looking through the stuff, and somebody finds a ball. And so the kids, because they're kids, they start throwing the ball around. This is a Saturday afternoon. They start throwing the ball around, tossing it back and forth. In the midst of being kids, the ball, somebody misses it, and it goes through the window. Crash. So we continued our work. We continued our work, doing our things, made a ton of progress, cleaned up a bunch of stuff, got rid of a bunch of stuff. Like, you could actually go up in the balcony and sit there if you wanted, right? I get to the church for worship the next Sunday afternoon at 2:45, and what do you think was the very first thing I heard about? The window's broken. Not how clean the balcony is, not, oh, wow, what amazing work that happened. It's the window was broken, right? That was a bad sign. You may remember or may can anticipate the rest of the story. So we continued to try and do things, but over the course of the spring, that just became harder. Because the more the kind of kids wanted to do things this way, the more kind of the remnants kind of resisted and wanted to do something a different way, how they used to do things, right? And it became this kind of back and forth. And you know, we were only there for a year, and so we kind of talked through and talked with the leadership about how, you know, we need to try and transition this. And we talked through ways to do that and brainstormed ways to do that, and it just didn't really connect with these younger kids. And so we had a kind of end of our year party, and then we came back to England, or came back from England, and a couple of months later, we heard from folks there that the kids had stopped coming. And then about a year or so later, we heard that a few of those folks had passed away and that the church was at a place where it was going to close. And for me, that's always been a very powerful story for ministry, a parable for ministry, really. Because I think, what a missed opportunity for the kingdom. There was only one way forward for them, and they missed it for all kinds of reasons that I know all of us understand. Fear, discomfort, grief, overwhelming. But hear the words from Moses. Do not be afraid. Stand firm. Keep still. Don't panic. Stay steady. Keep going. Move forward. Whenever we come to the table, we are reminded that no matter the season that we're walking through, no matter whether we're being carried, even those seasons when we get thump, dropped, that God continues to be with us. That God is present. And God and God's love and care and concern will be with us and guide us. And so we remember that Jesus gathered his friends in a room and he broke bread. And he shared it with them and said, take this and eat. This is my body which is broken and given for you. And he took a cup and he blessed it and he shared it and said, drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you gather and remember me. And so we've gathered to remember God's presence, God's power, God's grace and love that are always with us. And so as we do that, I invite you to pray with me. Lord God, we just pray that you, Holy Spirit, would pour out on these gifts of bread and juice. Make them be for us your body and your blood. God, strengthen us through this grace, Lord God, to be your body in the world. And we pray this, Lord, in Jesus' name. And all of God's people said, amen. I want to invite those who are helping serve, if you would come at this time. And as they are coming to assist with communion this morning, I want to invite, remind you that all are invited to come to the table. We practice what's called an open table in the United Methodist Church, which means all are invited and welcome to come. You don't have to be a member here. You just need to be a person who desires to come and to grow in knowledge and grace and love with God. And so all are invited to come. your gifts. Lord God, we pray that you will bless and multiply these gifts, Lord, to build your kingdom and do your work. And we pray this, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please join me for two verses of He Leadeth Me, O Blessed Thought.
Let's go from this place to love and serve the Lord. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Please sing the choruses with me on El Shaddai. I have a verse to sing in the middle, and it's about our sermon topic today, so I hope you enjoy that.
El Shaddai, El Shaddai, Elayon Adonai, age to age you're still the same, by the power of the name. El Shaddai, El Shaddai, Erkam Kana Adonai, we will praise and lift you high, El Shaddai. Love and through the ram, you saved the son of Abraham. Through the power of your hand, you turned the sea into dry land. To the outcast on her knees, you were the God who really sees. And by your might, you set your children free. El Shaddai, El Shaddai, Elayon Adonai, age to age you're still the same, by the power of the name. El Shaddai, El Shaddai, Erkam Kana Adonai, we will praise and lift you high, El Shaddai.
And we're going to invite you to be seated for the postlude. We have a special presentation, and in honor of the chariots that followed Moses into the Red Sea, and in honor of the movie Chariots of Fire, where the Jewish and Christian runners work together for the good of each other and for their country, and the Olympics this summer. I hope you enjoy the slideshow. You may be seated for the slideshow while the bells play Chariots of Fire.